Order members, the next item of business is the second stage of the Rates Relief for Community Amateur Sports Clubs Bill. As a valid petition of concern was presented on Monday the 19th of October in relation to the second stage of the bill, the vote will be on a cross-community basis. I call Mr Daki Mackay to move the second stage of the Rates Relief for Community Amateur Sports Clubs Bill and open the debate on the bill. Mr Mackay.
I get the last lawyer. I beg to move that the second stage of the Rates Relief for Community Amateur Sports Clubs Bill be agreed. And to start with, the last lawyer, can I say that I think this is one of the most extraordinary abuses of the petition of concern that we've seen in this chamber, in this assembly, for this bill, for this issue to be put as the subject of a petition of concern and a cross-community vote. And I believe the public find it extraordinary the levels to which some members would stoop to torpedo such a proposal. So the bill, in effect, is torpedoed before the debate even starts today. So what's the point, some may ask? I think that members and certain parties should consider how abusive they are of this mechanism and of this assembly, and I hear some members tutting, but that's exactly what it is. And it's a great shame that knowing that many MLAs here would support this measure, the DUP have decided to kill this bill. And I ask why. You know, we will probably hear a number of red herrings. We've heard a number of red herrings already in terms of state aid cases in England. In terms of the views of the hospitality sector. And I will return to those later. But the question also has to be asked, was it because the Minister wanted to bring her own bill forward, as she has already suggested, and going by what members of her party have said in terms of the social media, in terms of the radio today, that appears to be the case. You know, so we are now coming quite rapidly to the end of this particular term. Legislation will no doubt be piling up, and the Minister is bringing forward a bill that may not even get to this floor, may not even get passed. And I think it's important that community and amateur sports clubs know that fact. I certainly hope, alas, Concord, that it wasn't because certain vested interests or businesses close to the DUP did not see it as being in their interest. Oh, that would not surprise me either. And the party opposite have also said that the consultation wasn't appropriate, that the consultation didn't go far enough. But the department and the minister have already said that in bringing forward their bill that they want to skip the committee stage. Now, here we have a bill in front of us that, if passed here today, would go to the Finance and Personnel Committee for proper committee scrutiny. And of course, as the party opposite have already indicated, they want to bring forward a bill that would not be subject to such scrutiny. So the appropriate mechanism for moving this issue forward in terms of whatever the appropriate support is to be put in place for amateur sports clubs is this bill. And I believe the party opposite know that, that this is the only opportunity that we're going to get to put in place proper and effective support for community and amateur sports clubs that are suffering in the community. And I believe that most parties in this Assembly recognise that this is a straightforward, this is a simple proposal, and is one that we should vote for here today. What I really find astonishing, alas, County Clare, is the accusation that we are rushing into this. Anything but. My constituency colleague, Robin Swan, MLA, moved a motion here in November 2011. And that read that this Assembly recognises the benefits which community and amateur sport clubs bring to local communities, notes the vital role which they play in encouraging participation in sporting activities, and the contribution they make in promoting healthy lifestyles, and calls on the Minister of Finance and Personnel to raise the rate relief afforded to these clubs from 80 to 100% to ensure parity with equivalent clubs and what he refers to as other parts of the UK. The motion was amended by the DUP at that time to call upon the Minister, who was Mr Sammy Wilson, to examine the rate relief afforded to these clubs. But there was no doubt at that time that the general view of members was that the increase from 80 to 100% was indeed a good thing. So that was 4 years ago. And if you go back 9 years ago, there was also a view that sports halls should have been included in the rates order 2006. And I remember well that time my party colleague Barry McIlduff raising that issue on behalf of sports clubs in the locality. So this is not a proposal that has been rushed into. Quite clearly, it is the opposite. And I want, from the outset, to thank the gentleman from Armoy, who first gave me the idea to undertake this piece of work some 3 years ago. His name shall remain anonymous, but I can assure members that it's not Mervyn Storey. I'd also like to thank the Sports Forum, Ms Katie Nixon, Mr Kieran Kearney, Mr Ken Armstrong, the manager of Belfast Bowls Club, and Patrice Hardy, who ably assisted me in our first presentation to the Finance Committee in May 2014. There was huge support for this bill. We received an excess of 1,000 responses in support. And I take a sip of water for a reason. These included Fermanagh District Council, Ballyclare Golf Club, Colban Clay Pigeon Club, Lagan Valley Orienteers, St Bridget's Cross Community Amateur Boxing Club, Bernardine's Cycling Club, Salto Gymnastics Centre, Glendowan Football Club, Dungannon Rugby Club, also in support, Ahali Taekwondo Club, Saints Amateur Boxing Club, Abbey Gymnastics. And the reason I'm reading out all these names, these groups will not have an opportunity to contribute to the committee stage of this bill by writing our oral. So it's important that these contributions are put on the record. Ulster Clay Pigeon Shooting Association, Green Island Ladies Hockey Club, Valley Rangers Football Club, Ulster Angling Federation, Coleraine Rugby Club and Cricket Club, Oak Athletic Football Club, British Gymnastics, Slatneale GAC, Ballymoney Gymnastics, Twisters Gymnastics, Asylum Weightlifting Club in Newton Ards, Warren Point Town Football Club, Flight Gymnastics Academy, Ardmore Cricket and Football Club, Brigade Cricket Club, Banbridge Rugby Football Club, Belfast Wattle Can Karate Club, Malone Rugby, Clougher Valley Rugby Football Club, Ulster Gliding Club, Pan Disability Lisburn, Bamenden Club, NI Orienteering, Coleraine Yacht Club, Antrim Hockey Club, the Ulster Branch of the Irish Rugby Football Union, the Ulster Seaplane Association, Ballyclare Rugby Football Club, Kazuki Karate, Carrickfergus Rugby Football Club, Sandy Hill Football Club, McQuillan's GAC Ballycastle, Belfast Canoe Club, Armagh Rugby Club, Lurgan Institute FC, Beira Red Knights from West Tyrone, Donaghadee Ladies Netball Club, Ballymena Rugby Club, the Lochiel Shamrocks, Craigavon City Football Club, Dauphin Transport Cycling Club, Carrickfergus Ladies Junior Hockey Club, St Joseph's Amateur Boxing Club, University of Ulster Jordanstown Canoe Club, Causeway Coast Kayak Association, Ballymena Road Club, Banbridge District Council, Mosley Hockey Club, North Down Cycling Club, Apollo Cycling Team, Banbridge Hockey Club, Larn Rugby Football Club, Belfast Harlequins, Dunbarton Bowling Club, Ramelstown Ladies Hockey Club, Lakeland Cycling Club, Strabane Lifford Cycling Club, Rainey Old Boys Rugby Football Club, City of Derry Rugby Football Club, North Down Cycling Club, Tyrone GAA, Bangor Men's Hockey Club, East Coast Athletic Club, Armagh City FC, Portanone GAC and Jurling's Camogie Club, Killiecluny Cricket Club, Strabane Cricket Club, Five Mile Town United, Pegasus Hockey Club, Myola Park Football Club, Limavady Cricket and Rugby Club, Breedy Cricket Club, Hollywood Ladies Hockey Club, Coleraine Ladies Hockey Club, Ban Rowing Club, Downpatrick Cricket Club, Riverdale Football Club, Red Hog Wrestling Club, Chimney Corner FC, Kaizan Jiu-Jitsu Association, Ranaldstown Rugby Football Club, Falls Bowling Club, St Mary's GAC Rishargan, Grosvenor Rugby Football Club, Dundrum Cricket Club, Laurenvale Cricket Club, Cairn Money Ladies Football Club, Portadown Tennis Club, Cairnini Amateur and Youth Football Club, Lochgill Camogie Club, Mahara Cricket Club, Go Lift Weightlifting Newton Abbey, Oma Thunder Basketball Club, Cuchulainn's Dunloy, Tandragee Rovers Splits and Flips Gymnastics, Glentoran Football Club, East Belfast Yacht Club, Lisburn Rackets, Ballinafy Tennis and Squash Club, Cumber Recreation Football Club, Ballynagross FC, Aquinas FC, Larne Football Club, Sydenham United Football Club, Causeway Netball Club, R Class Football Club, the NI Jiu-Jitsu Association, North End United FC, Swim Ulster, the Star Amateur Boxing Club, Carnlough Swifts Football Club, St Mary's GAC Ahahol, Ulster GAA, and Ballykelly Cross Community Amateur Boxing Club, all in favour of this bill. And that last conclusion is just the name but a few. I could have put members through a lot more names of clubs that responded to this consultation. In total, out of 1,033 replies to the consultation, 1,022 supported the proposal, 5 against, 6 were unsure. It is supported by the NI Sports Forum, the Irish Football Association, the Gaelic Athletic Association and Ulster Rugby. The Sports Forum carried out a survey of members that showed that this move would help relieve stress on clubs and would result in huge benefits for the entire community. We also had overwhelming support at public consultations we held in Enniskillen, Dungannon, Omagh, Strabane and Belfast. And what was quite clear from those public consultations is that clubs are suffering. There has been an economic downturn. There's less money out there for sponsorship. I know of one rugby club within my own constituency who had quite a significant sponsor. That sponsor fell upon hard times, and that club now has to try and fill the gap that has been left behind. And of course, in terms of what we have in place here for support for community amateur sports clubs, there's less support here than there is for clubs in the south or indeed clubs across the water. And this is outlined in excellent research by Colin Pidgeon within this building. In the south, the Valuation Act 2001 outlined that land designed for sport is exempt from rates. This refers to outdoor surfaces, including football pitches, tennis courts, race courses and golf courses, but not fixed buildings and structures. However, a further rates exemption in the same Act concerns properties used as community halls. These are not used primarily for profit or gain. Involves participation of local inhabitants and is for recreational purposes or otherwise social. This does exclude halls that sell alcohol, but all in all, a much better deal in the south for clubs than in the north. Under the CASC scheme in Britain, clubs can avail of 80% relief from non-domestic rates, and there is discretion for the remaining 20% to be relieved by local authorities. Again, we do not have such an option here in the north. And amateur clubs and their volunteers save us millions of pounds. They save money for central government here at the Assembly. They save money for local government. You know, if these clubs weren't there, if these clubs didn't fundraise and put in place pitches, put in place halls for sporting activities, it would be the local councils that will be providing the facilities instead. So local councils over the years have saved millions and millions of pounds by the activities and the voluntary work and the fundraising within the community that these clubs have carried out. And of course they've also saved us significant money in terms of physical and mental health costs. Clubs clearly prevent health problems developing, such as obesity. And this last conclusion is not appreciated enough. Most recent figures show that spending on sport contributes £452 million per annum to the economy, or 2% of GDP, from 2006-07. The 2010 Decal and Sport NI publication, The Economic Importance of Sport in NI, found that sport-related activity adds £638.6 million into the economy. And that's 2.3% of total GVA, or gross value added. But the real benefit for me is public health. What this bill will help deliver is better health outcomes, because sport tackles obesity, sport tackles diabetes, and sport improves our mental health and well-being. And what is the cost of obesity? In 2012, an estimate put the impact in terms of the cost of treating obesity at £3 million per annum. In terms of lost earnings due to premature death, £22 million. Lost earnings due to illness, £47 million. The total economic cost estimated between 2007 and 2008, so it would have risen significantly since then, was £350 million. And the indirect cost of overweightness and obesity, £7.4 million. A 2012 All-Ireland study concluded that the findings on the cost of overweight and obesity highlight the need for significant investment in research to examine the influence of fiscal and other government policies on consumer purchasing and their impact on overweight and obesity, including, for example, risk-benefits assessment of taxation that supports healthy eating and active living. At a recent knowledge exchange seminar in the Assembly, Hassan and Hughes stated, "For all the underlying scepticism and caution, in the main there appears to be an emerging, credible body of literature reporting an association between organised youth sports and positive health-related educational and social outcomes. This is specifically the case in relation to youth, with lower capabilities for participation due to economic, cultural or social features, as sports are viewed as an opportunity to engage such vulnerable young people in a leisure context, not only in terms of participation in sports, but also across a range of related activities. For example, in a recent British cohort study, it was found that for vulnerable groups, sport club attendance at the age of 16 years reduced the chance of social exclusion outcomes at the age of 30 years. So the evidence is overwhelming. Sport clubs provide a public service, yet get little in return. And I would urge members to use their foresight to see what the benefits of this could be. A lot of clubs are holding back on capital build, capital investment, because of the additional rates burden. With the rate exemption, a full rate exemption and extra finance, this bill would give the green light for new changing rooms, new stands, new pitches, new facilities for communities in rural areas and urban areas alike. I hope the Assembly will support this bill today. This will not apply to bars. It's quite clear in the bill, and there's been a bit of confusion out there and deliberately been put about that this bill will cover bars. It will not. Now, there clearly is existing legislation in place, but I have taken into account the views of those in the hospitality sector. I've spoken to the owners of bars. I've spoken to the owners of bars who are supporters of amateur sport clubs, of amateur sport, and they see no issue with the bill. They believe it's fair, they believe it's balanced, and the fact that the 100% relief will not apply to licensed premises on clubs is the common sense way forward. So I do not understand, or maybe I do understand, some of the approaches that have been taken, but they certainly do not stand up to any scrutiny. In terms of this being a bad consultation, we had over 1,000 replies. You know, and many consultations from the Department of Finance and Personnel have got over 100 replies, never mind 1,000. You know, so the consultation has been comprehensive. The committee put out a call over the summer for witnesses to come forward. There was no responses to that. But then again, there was, in terms of that, there was no concerns raised. You know, there's this impression that is given that there's huge concern out there about this bill. There's not. Overwhelmingly, the public supported, and certainly the reaction on social media and Twitter last night would back that up. The cost, and I've tried to get figures from the department, and in terms of the cost for community and amateur sports clubs, the latest figures from DFP, and I suppose there is a need to attach some caution to this, was £420,000 per annum. But of course, I would recognise that with the introduction of this and with the application from a number of clubs to join the CAS scheme, that would certainly rise. But all in all, if this is £1 million, £2 million, £3 million, what you're getting back in return is much greater than what you're losing in terms of revenue. In terms of health and well-being, this is a public service that delivers health and well-being. I know a number of clubs in rural areas. I represent the rural constituency, and they have diversified more and more in recent years in terms of what they offer in, health, in terms of health and well-being. There's events such as the Biggest Loser, where there's competitions to lose weight that involve a lot of physical activity, a lot of running, and the competition within the community actually helps bring that community closer together in terms of social cohesion. They organise marathons, organise half marathons, cycling events, they hold health awareness days, suicide awareness, big issue in rural areas as well, organised by community and amateur sports clubs. They offer critical support for young people at a very vulnerable time in their lives. They teach young people leadership and they provide life skills. So that, taken in the whole, is a significant public service that needs to be recognised. The bill and its clauses, would amend the Rates CNI Order 1977. And at present, amateur sport clubs can avail of rates relief of 88%. To qualify for the relief, the amateur sports club must comply with the requirements of Article 31, excuse me, and in particular fall within the definition of a prescribed recreation as outlined in legislation. My amendments to the bill would exempt community amateur sports clubs or CASCs from the payment of rates. And the CASCs were introduced in 2002 to support grassroots sport and supports local amateur sport clubs to register with HMRC as a sports club rather than a business for rates and tax purposes. So clubs that are not community amateur sports clubs will continue to be able to avail of the 80% rate relief, and clubs that are registered as CASCs will get 100% rate relief. The 100% rate relief will not apply to the part of any club which sells alcohol other than by way of occasional licence, but will apply to the rest of the club premises in terms of a hall, in terms of gym facilities, in terms of playing fields, etc. The bill has four clauses. Clause 1 amends Article 31 of the 1977 Order. Clause 1, Section 2 to Section 6 amends Article 31 to outline two categories of hereditaments, one including casks and the other applying to other clubs which currently benefit from relief. Clause 1, Section 7 inserts a new paragraph which affects 100% relief for casks. Section 8 applies the apportionment provisions to casks, i.e. where part of the hereditament is shown on the net annual value list as not being used for qualifying purposes. It is valued at the normal rate. Section 9 and 10 makes amendments to add new definitions of licensed premises, qualifying purposes and registered casks, and makes clear that licensed premises cannot be considered for qualifying purposes. Clause 2 amends Article 44 of the 1977 Order and allows for apportionment of net annual value between parts used for qualifying purposes and other parts. It simply states that such apportionment should be shown on the list. Clause 3 states that the bill comes into operation the day after it completes the legislative process or legislative stages. Clause 4 provides a short title of the bill, and that is all there is to it. This bill, last count, Coir, is not going to cost the earth. Based on the cask, this relief it would cost £420,000, as I've already said. Now, if you were to take into consideration community amateur sports clubs and those that are amateur sports clubs not covered by the cask definition, this would be somewhere in the region of £1.4 million from latest figures. And in the public meetings we held, a lot of clubs said that they wanted to expand their services and to build new stands, new club rooms, and they are factoring in the additional rates costs that they would have year on year. So it is preventing them from doing those things. Although they would gladly meet the upfront capital costs for such expansions, they are wary of having the additional rates cost year on year and believe that that is putting those projects beyond their reach. One respondent to the consultation referred to the epidemic of obesity, especially among the youth, and they said that it is the promotion of amateur sports participation that will prove the most cost-effective method of preventing soaring health costs that will cripple our economy. The small loss of revenue from rates exempting amateur sports clubs is more than compensated by it being a significant investment in proactive health care. I think there's no better way of putting it. What amateur sports clubs are is proactive health care in terms of what they give to our communities. Ken Armstrong of Belfast Indoor Bowls Club, just to cite another example, outlined to the Finance Committee that they have a rates bill of some £13,000 per annum, even with the existing rates relief. And that does not include increases in lighting, electricity, utility costs that they're also struggling with. And they want to invest, but the rates overheads are blocking that. So to conclude, alas, Colin Coyer, this is a progressive bill. It's a good news story, a potential good news story for this Assembly, for this administration. And it's minimal cost for significant health and social impact. And in terms of this process, this is second stage of this bill. you know, we have a committee stage where all the parties in this chamber, if they have issues with the bill, can tease them out. We have consideration stage where the department or any party in this House can put amendments forward to the bill. We have further consideration stage where any party in this House or the department can put amendments to this bill. And we have final stage, so if some parties aren't happy, they can vote against it at that stage. I believe it's a great shame that the DUP has not allowed us to have that debate, that they've abused this process, they've abused this Assembly and this Chamber, and once again today they give this place a bad name, because amateur sports clubs across the North will be disappointed that we couldn't even have the conversation, we couldn't even have the debate about applying this much-needed relief to our grassroots communities. Now, I look forward to what the Minister says. I don't believe she can provide any reasonable excuse for the petition of concern. But at the end of the day, this bill is on the table and it should have been given consideration along with any other bill. And if members here wanted to vote this bill down today, I would have been happy enough to accept that. But this is not a bill that should ever have been subject to petition of concern. So I look forward to the debate among members here this afternoon, and I look forward to that.
Call Mr. Dominic Bradley.
Gramila Mayogat Alas Concordia Agus Irium Lorch or son and Kostya Aragadish Agus Parson Ra an Dara Kimden Villasha Frishu Rati the club in the sports amateuraca. Beme duspare glorcher son costia agus aniation her son mafarti hien. Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I rise to speak initially on behalf of the Committee for Finance and Personnel on the Rates Relief for Community Amateur Sports Clubs Bill. And then subsequently on behalf of my own party. So, Mr. Speaker, I want to begin by thanking the member for outlining the general principles of his bill and his rationale for bringing forward the proposed legislation. And I also welcome the opportunity to debate this bill on behalf of the Committee for Finance and Personnel, which, unfortunately, it would seem, will not now have the opportunity to scrutinise the provisions of the bill because of the laying of a petition of concern. But, Mr. Deputy Speaker, rather than rehearsing the main principles of the bill, as the sponsor has already outlined them, I shall briefly refer to the main points arising from the committee's preliminary consideration of the policy proposals contained in the bill. In undertaking its preliminary scrutiny of the proposals, the committee has found itself in an unusual, if not unique, position whereby the committee chairperson is also the bill sponsor. Procedural advice was received in terms of good practice for handling such a scenario, and this resulted in the chairperson stepping aside from the chair and declaring the necessary interest during the discussions on the proposed bill. And I take this opportunity to declare an interest as a member of St Patrick's Gaelic Football Club, Carrickcroppen. So I expect that this approach would have been continued by the chair if the bill were to be referred to committee stage, but as I said earlier, it appears now that this will not be the case. The committee received an initial oral briefing from the bill sponsor on the 7th of May 2014. Mr. Mackay was accompanied by Mr. Ken Armstrong, representing Belfast Indoor Bowls Club, and by Ms. Katie Nixon, representing the Northern Ireland Sports Forum. During this session, the witness highlighted a number of points, including the important contribution to local communities made by amateur sports clubs, including the value of volunteering. He also mentioned the public, physical and mental health benefits of sport, including in terms of preventative spending on conditions such as obesity and diabetes. The other social benefits, including in terms of better community relations, stronger community spirit and activities for young people, leading to a reduction in antisocial behaviour. The sponsor of the bill referred to the comparatively more generous arrangements in other places. He also made reference to the increased financial pressures on amateur sports club with increased utility costs and other overheads and reduced opportunities for commercial sponsorship. The witnesses also pointed to the diversity of sports clubs which responded to the policy consultation and the overwhelmingly positive response in that regard. And finally, the point was made that the cost of increasing the relief from 80% to 100% would be modest compared to the potential benefits. And Mr. Deputy Speaker, another issue identified during the evidence session on the 7th of May 2014 was the potential for sports clubs which are registered as community amateur sports clubs, CASCs, to be disadvantaged in comparison to those which are registered charities, with the latter being able to avail of 100% rate relief. And a further issue was raised around circumstances in which professionals and amateurs shared premises. In pursuing these and other issues discussed, the committee commissioned Assembly research to examine the position in Britain and in the Republic of Ireland. In terms of the additional discretionary 20% relief offered by local authorities in Britain, the research found that the criteria vary considerably from authority to authority. While the most frequently used criterion relates to a club's provision of licensed bar facilities, such provision does not necessarily prevent the club from receiving relief. Also, clubs do not necessarily have to own the facilities that they use in order to qualify for a CASC status, and amateur clubs that share facilities with professional clubs are not automatically prevented from receiving CASC status. In that regard, CASC clubs are allowed to pay professional members to coach, work in the club, and also to play up to a limit of £10,000 per year. Following the introduction of the bill to the Assembly, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that was before the summer recess, and with a review to maximising the use of the time available, the committee issued a call for evidence on the bill, which ran from the 8th of July to the 2nd of September 2015. And while this included public notices being placed in the provincial papers and notices on the digital media, only one submission was received, which was from Hospitality Ulster, formerly known as Pubs of Ulster. In its submission, which was circulated to committee members ahead of today's debate, Hospitality Ulster raised concern that many of the clubs that will benefit under the bill are licensed premises, and many of those operate as commercial businesses and in direct competition with pubs and hotels and restaurants. Hospitality Ulster further argued that, and I quote, any revised rating model for sports clubs should take account of the hospitality industry's circumstances and its role as a key economic driver. By not introducing any relief scheme that would result in additional unfair competition, this could be done by limiting the relief to unlicensed sports clubs. In terms of this concern, I note from the explanatory and financial memorandum to the bill that the 100% rate relief for casks will not apply to the part of the club which sells alcohol, other than by way of occasional licence, but will apply to the rest of the club, the gymnasia, playing fields, etc. In more recent correspondence circulated to committee members yesterday, Hospitality Ulster acknowledges this point but calls for the Assembly to delay this bill and include this matter in the review of business rates, which is to be undertaken by DFP. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I expect therefore that members will wish to consider this issue further during today's debate. No doubt, if the bill were to move to committee stage, there would be a further opportunity for all stakeholders, including the business community, to provide their views on the proposals and to put forward suggestions for any necessary amendments. Finally, Mr. Deputy Speaker, the committee is aware that DFP has raised concerns around the bill, which were outlined in correspondence from the Minister of Finance and during oral evidence from departmental officials on the 15th of September 2015. Indeed, the Department indicated that it would oppose the bill as drafted. I expect that the Minister will explain this in more detail today, but from the briefing received on the 15th of September, the opposition appears to be on the basis of DFP seeing a need for further consultation and policy development to take account of the views of the business community and some other departments. The Department has argued that a more suitable vehicle would be its proposed Rates Amendment Bill, which would enable, which would include an enabling power to allow provision to be made for enhanced relief through subordinate legislation at a later date and following consultation with the business community. In closing, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I look forward to the further contributions to this debate from other members, and I am sure that if the bill were to progress to committee stage, the committee would ensure that it would receive robust scrutiny and that the views of all the stakeholders, including the sports bodies as well as the business groups, would be heard. So that finishes my contribution on behalf of the Committee for Finance and Personnel. On behalf of the SDLP, I state now that the SDLP supports the general principles behind this bill and will be voting in favour of the bill at this its second stage. And the reasons for that, Mr. Deputy Speaker, are quite clear. The general principles behind this bill, we believe, are worthwhile, positive and beneficial to the whole community here in Northern Ireland. The health benefits, both physical and mental, have already been outlined by the sponsor of the bill, and he referred to the beneficial effects the provisions of the bill could have on such illnesses as diabetes and obesity in general. So one could say that this bill could be categorised as an invest-to-save measure. Also, it's quite clear that community sports clubs contribute hugely to community cohesion. We all know that sports brings people together, not only within a single identity community, but on a cross-community basis, and support improves community spirits, lifts communities, and the health benefits range across all age groups, from the young to older people. The voluntary effort which is put into the work of community sports clubs is huge, and it's difficult to quantify in monetary terms that voluntary effort. It is huge, and I think it's only but right that government should repay that effort in this small way which this bill proposes. As I said earlier on, the investment is quite minuscule, really, in proportion to the huge advantages that could ensue from the bill. And the provisions of the bill would enable community sports clubs to provide for greater investment in better facilities for their members, and also for better equipment as well. We heard from the sponsor the wide and diverse support that there is from sports club right across Northern Ireland and right across the community. Indeed, he said the list that he read out, it took some time, was not exhaustive. So there is a huge groundswell of support for this measure among sports clubs and among sports people, and I think the department and this House should take cognizance of that. I regret the fact that it now looks as if the bill will not benefit from the robust committee stage scrutiny, and I'm sure that the committee stage would have enabled members of the committee to iron out any anomalies and to fine-tune the bill, and indeed amendments could have been brought forward at the consideration stage and at the further consideration stage. So the laying of a petition of concern was highly, or is highly, inappropriate. I believe that it's anti-democratic insofar as it denies the democratic institutions here the opportunity to examine, improve and scrutinise an important piece of legislation which will benefit the whole community. Mr Deputy Speaker, I watched a programme last night on BBC Two. It was called Taobh an Gcéanaí, Behind the Jersey. And a young man from Belfast, Anula O'Carolan, he looked at the problem of suicide among young sports people in the GAA. And he also examined the measures that were taken by that organisation in order to improve the mental health of its young members. And the message that constantly came from the various sections of that programme was, it's okay to talk. So that's an example of the type of work that community sports clubs do for the mental health of our young people. And I believe that this measure would give them even more facility to do even more work and to improve even more the mental health of the young people who use their facilities and who are their members. So it's a cause of some regret that the petition of concern which has been led will not allow us to progress this bill. But having said that, the SDLP agrees with the general principle of the bill. We commend the member for bringing it forward, and we would urge all members of this House to support it. Alaskan Kole, Krech Noime, Erfuntishin, Gurukid Mayoga. Thank you very much.
Call Mr. Neil Somerville.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. This bill today deals with a subject which has previously been before this House. There was an Ulster Unionist motion in November 2011 which called the Assembly to recognise the benefits which community and amateur sports clubs bring to local communities. Note the vital role which they play in encouraging participation in sporting activities and the contribution they make in promoting healthy lifestyles, and called on the Minister of Finance and Personnel to raise the relief rate afforded to these clubs from 80% to 100% to ensure parity with equivalent clubs in parts of the UK. The arguments advanced in favour of this measure in 2011 still hold true today. The bill currently before us has the same intent, and therefore I am happy to say at the outset that it will receive support from the Ulster Unionist Party. It is, however, a matter of deep disappointment that the DUP has chosen to table a petition of concern against this bill, and as a result, it is doomed to failure. This is nothing less than an abuse of the process. Petitions of concern were designed to protect minorities from being discriminated against. They were never intended to be used as a mechanism to thwart what one might term run-of-the-mill legislation. It is precisely this type of action that helps bring the Assembly into disrepute. In recent weeks, we have witnessed the unidentifying spectacle of the DUP ministers signing in and resigning. We have had empty benches as the Assembly debated waiting lists on autism, yet the DUP managed to turn up to protect the pay and conditions of their highly paid special advisers. Then, as today, the public will draw their own conclusion to who and what the DUP exists to serve. Had the DUP not taken the action to table a petition of concern, then we would have been here today debating a bill that would make a real positive difference to the lives of many of our citizens. Sadly, the actions of the DUP have rendered this debate academic. A rates reduction would have been a great boost to dozens of sports clubs throughout Northern Ireland. Currently, amateur sports clubs in Northern Ireland can, under Article 31 of the Rates Northern Ireland Order 1977, qualify for a reduction in rates relief of 80%. This bill would amend the 1977 order to make them exempt from rates, a measure which would have been of great financial benefit to them. It is undoubtedly the case that in recent years many sports clubs have been struggling to make ends meet. The Community Amateur Sports Clubs scheme was introduced in April 2002 to support grassroots sport and enables local amateur sports clubs to register with Revenue and Customs as a sports club rather than a business, so they can benefit from a range of tax reliefs, including gift aid. The conditions for becoming a community amateur sports club are as follows. A club must be open to the whole community, be organised on an amateur basis, have its main purpose providing facilities for and promoting participation in one or more eligible sports, meet the location requirement, meet the management conditions. There is no question that such clubs play a positive role within their communities. They help improve public health by encouraging participation in healthy sporting activities. They also promote individual self-discipline, build the concept of teamwork, can help reduce antisocial behaviour, promote local pride and draw in young people. There are obvious benefits in terms of physical and mental health, and in the prevention of illness such as obesity and diabetes. There are an estimated 37,000 volunteers in community sports in Northern Ireland, and a wide variety of sports are affected, ranging from football, rugby, Gaelic games, right through to badminton, athletics, tennis, squash and sailing, to name but a few. And as Mr McKay has already noted, that my party colleague Robin Swan has been working closely with the Northern Ireland Pigeon Association in regard to bringing forward an amendment which would have seen homing pigeon club halls across Northern Ireland being exempt from rates. The DUP will have to explain their reasoning to them and every other sports club in the country whose hopes of a major economic boost have been dashed. In terms of the cost of this measure, figures from 2010-2011 indicated that the figure was £1.4 million. This is not a massive figure in terms of the overall Northern Ireland budget, and bearing in mind the existing and projected cost to the health budget of diabetes and obesity, it would be money very well spent in terms of prevention. No doubt the DUP will try to explain why they have chosen to vote this measure down. One excuse that is not open to them is the notion that the Department of Finance and Personnel is planning to bring its own bill forward. They have had almost 4 years since the 22nd of November 2011 to do that. How much time do they need?
Mr. Barry Michael Duff.
John Corlia, thank you, Deputy Speaker. I want to commend Dahi McKay for moving the second stage of the rates relief for community amateur sports clubs bill, and to note at the outset of my contribution that the objective of the bill is to exempt community amateur sports clubs from the payment of rates. I'm very heartened by the comments of Neil Somerville and Dominic Bradley in the course of the debate as well. There is a consensus, one would suggest, at the importance of this issue. Now, it has been criticised, the idea that a petition of concern has been introduced by the DUP in this bill discussion to effectively guillotine it from this point onwards. And the sponsor of the bill did say that that amounted to an extraordinary abuse. And other members have suggested that robust scrutiny lay ahead at different stages of consideration, not least the committee stage of the bill. And truly astonishing, the blocking of this bill, that has been another phrase that has been used. I just want to amplify that there is huge support for this bill in the community, and that's why the question that has already been presented for those bringing the petition of concern, who do you exist to serve when such a blatant abuse of the petition of concern has taken place? Dahi did explain that well over 1,000 responses came in, and I myself attended an event in the Struil Arts Centre in Oma, which was very well attended, very well participated in, and clubs in our community across numerous sporting codes. I distinctly remember the enthusiasm of Oma Lawn Tennis Club for this particular bill, also Oma Bowling Club and Drumra Sarsfield GAC. They were three of the clubs that I remember being particularly enthusiastic at the Oma consultation event. And I thought it was appropriate that Dahi should read from the list, because it's clear from the geography, the sporting codes that Dahi referred to, that this is absolutely cross-community in its character. Absolutely cross-community in its character. Other members have talked about the important contribution to local communities made by sports clubs. And it is not too great an exaggeration to say that in many communities, the sports club is the community, is the very essence of the community. And that sports club takes on many more functions than merely providing sport and recreation. In my own community, GAA clubs in particular are increasingly becoming the health promotion agency in our communities. They are synonymous with this type of activity, with the fight against obesity, the fight against diabetes, increasing people's participation in sport in a very targeted way, like football for mums. All these types of initiatives are emanating from community-rooted sports clubs. And you know, this society, the North, but all over the island of Ireland, I do believe we could go forward as an exemplar for the rest of Europe and indeed the world in terms of community rootedness in sport. I also welcome the fact that the sponsor of the bill was very clear in his assertion that this does not refer to public bar aspects of club rooms, for example, and that that would be dealt with separately. And indeed, certainly in my community, very few clubs actually have bars. And in fact, the ones that are most successful on the field of play tend not to have bars. And I could be entering into stormy waters there if there's a tight scrutiny on that in Tyrone, but it appears to me, for example, Trillick St McCartan's won the county title this year. They don't have a bar. And the entire community got behind the Trillick Club in their quest for glory this year. I mean, the day of the county final, you would have needed somebody left behind in the community to act as a caretaker for the community, because there wouldn't have been a sinner in Trillick that day. The McCanns and the Donnellys and the Gormleys, they were all Noma, every single one of them. So this is proper community-rooted stuff. And I have to say, I can't understand the rationale for opposing it. And that's why I was heartened by Neil Somerville's contribution, because it kind of reinforced my own notion that this defies rationale, the idea that this would be blocked. It was a very good process that Dahi Mackay undertook. Very good process indeed. Very robust consultation exercise with strong public interest. I also agree with the argument being made that increasing the rates burden or retaining the rates burden on amateur sports clubs prevents their capacity for capital development. That is a very strong point. Now, in the course of the bill being debated this evening, I noticed in the public gallery some people from my own community who I believe are here this evening for a local government related event, and some of them are involved in the hospitality industry, and I signalled to one or two of them that I would like to have a chat with them outside, and I conducted my own vox pop with them, hospitality providers in my community, in our community, about their views on this bill, and they were universally supportive of it. I would have to ask the question, how representative is Hospitality Ulster with its grand title, Hospitality Ulster? I don't think Hospitality Ulster can presume to speak for the hospitality industry in the province of Ulster. I think they're out of touch. I think they're way off beam here. They ignore good working relations between publicans and sporting clubs, and I would just certainly.
Would the member agree with me that many sports clubs hold their annual awards ceremony in the local hotel or restaurant, lounge or whatever? So rather than taking trade away from the hospitality industry, many sports clubs increase the trade of the hospitality industry.
Absolutely. And there are countless examples of that. Gala dinners are taken to hotels by and large. If you take a small community like Berra, just Berra Red Knights Club, it's my understanding that 800 people attended their gala dinner. And you know, you'll be glad to hear the member for Newry Armagh will be glad to hear that some of the Tyrone people even go into Armagh for these dinners. You know, on occasions we go to the Armagh City Hotel and such places for to have these big gala dinners. And I would ask the DUP to close their ears. Sometimes we go south. Sometimes we go to the Hillgrove in Monaghan, and we go to Ballybuffet.
Bundoran.
You know, we go to Bundoran. The sports clubs are massive contributors to the hospitality industry. And for me, I'm seriously questioning the bona fides of this outfit that describes itself as Hospitality Ulster, because they are misrepresenting the communities where I come from. They are strangers to my experience.
Order, please. At least I get a complaint later on. I must remind the member that particular organisation is not present.
That's fine. Nonetheless, I'm happy to stand over my general sense here that Hospitality Ulster does not deserve that title, and I would call on them to abandon that title because they don't represent anybody I know. They are strangers to my experience. Thank you.
Take it, Mr. Michael Duff, you're finished.
I
call Ms. Bronwyn McGahan.
Can Cordia, I thank you for the opportunity to speak in support of the full rates relief for amateur sports club. As a former Gaelic footballer and Gaelic for mothers who belong to the Una Celts club in Tyrone, and as a keen cyclist involved with my local club, this is an issue that I have a deep personal interest in. Amateur sporting groups are part of the fabric of our communities and essential to the future welfare of our young people in particular. For many of our citizens, the maxim, club is life, rings very true. As we know only too well, amateur sports clubs, rural and urban, are currently under pressure financially. And we know one of the main reasons for this is the economic downturn, as well as the opportunistic and deliberate British government policy of austerity, which is having a negative effects on fundraising in the communities in which amateur clubs are organised. The drying up of sponsorship from local construction firms with deep ties to their local communities has in particular affected rugby and GAA clubs. My party colleague, Dahi McKay, made reference to a number of submissions that were made to the consultation. Clubs from my own constituency, Five Mile Town United, Clogher Valley Rugby Club, Dungannon Rugby Club, and of course Tyrone GAA. Also as well, I attended a very interesting and important consultation event in Dungannon with Dahi. I know the pressures of fundraising to be true, as I spent a lot of time in my constituency signposting local clubs to new sources of monies by way of grants when funding opportunities are opening up at local government and European Union level. Funding that is open in terms of the club's plans for sports provision offered, which enhances youth development, healthy living, community cohesion, and other important goals, including peace building or tackling racism. It is my belief that the money saved by not paying any rates would be better spent on offering the range of measures that try to achieve the goals that I have mentioned, but especially on offering healthy alternatives for our young people to pursue, as well as enhancing well-being in our society generally for young and old. There is a public health aspect which has been mentioned to this issue, as I believe that by providing full relief for clubs, we are actually investing in public health. We are in particular investing in young people who are supported by these clubs, and we will receive a societal return in many ways by ensuring that these clubs are supported. Not only do our clubs encourage participation in sport and promote healthy lifestyles, they also make a positive contribution on the reduction of crime and antisocial behaviour and promote community relations, acting as a driver for positive community activity in our villages, towns and parishes. Today's debate allows us to promote a progressive agenda which seeks to advance public knowledge by exploring the challenges and opportunities for sport to act as a driver for change in our society. We know of the importance that sport and our leading sports people play in opening up awareness around issues in relation to important issues, such as the need for promoting good mental health of all our citizens. Let there be no doubt that the introduction of full rates relief for our sports clubs will help further enhance public health and promote well-being. Gurmi Ogut.
Call Mr. Sean Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to speak on the rates relief for community amateur sports clubs billed today. And I think it's very, very important to speak on this because, you know, we as legislators have a responsibility to everyone out there, but we have a particular responsibility to our young people. And coming from my educational background, we always talked about developing the whole person. Sport is very much part of that. They only spend a very, very small part of their day in school, but the opportunities they have in sport develops a lot of skills in them, whether that is teamwork, whether it's just, as other people refer to, health and fitness, whether it's just getting involved about volunteering and so on. So all those things are very, very important. As others have said, amateur sports clubs make a huge contribution to our society. Amateur sports are about participating without getting paid for it. Currently, all amateur sports clubs can avail of 80% rate relief, which is legislated for under the Rates Order of 1977. This was introduced to support grassroots sports. You know, Mr. McElduff talked about the sports club being the health promoting in the community. I would go further than that to say that many of our rural communities, it's the glue. It's the glue of our community. You know, if you travel through North Antrim, you'll see the young people out with their hurls. If you're in South Down, you'll find the football. In other parts, they'll be there with a rugby ball or soccer or whatever. You have some of these sports organisations who provide fantastic opportunities for the disabled. I can think of a group in my own area who do sailing for the disabled. As I go through Newcastle tonight, Newcastle AC will be out running the roads and so on. And I can think of the volunteerism and the work that has brought people along. People of the calibre of a former past pupil of mine, Kerry O'Flaherty, who represented Ireland recently in athletics.
Can the member give way?
Yes, I will, surely, yeah.
I don't want to be too facetious, but when I mentioned the distinguished Thrillick families, I forgot to mention the Kellys and the Brennans. But you know these type of people in County Down.
Yes, I do. And I think one thing I learned from Ms. McAduff's contribution earlier is I think I know who will not be sponsoring the Tyrone GA team next year. But we see in all our jurisdictions, under Schedule 4 of the Land Valuation Act, the rest of Ireland is exempt from paying commercial rates if it's developed for sport. In Scotland, England and Wales receive the 80% rate relief like ourselves, but local authorities then have the discretion to increase the relief up to 100%. Community amateur sports clubs relief was introduced by HMRC in 2002, enabling many local sports clubs to register with HMRC and benefit from a range of tax reliefs, including gift aid. And we all have these people calling to our doors, you know, they're going around collecting their pound for the lotto and so on. But I can think of one particular sports club in my own area who, even with the rate relief, still have to pay £1,000 per year in rates. There's a lot of £1 coins in that £1,000. There's a lot of collecting, and that's down to a lot of volunteers. So these community amateur sports clubs must be open to the whole community, be organised on an amateur basis, have its main purpose providing facilities for and promoting and participating in one or more eligible sports, meeting the location requirements and management conditions. Amateur sports clubs have seen their income severely reduced in recent years. This is for many reasons, including economic downturn, leading to less support from the local businesses, emigration of members. In 2011, the Assembly debated a motion calling for the rate relief for amateur sports clubs to be extended from 80 to 100%. The Assembly agreed to call on the Finance Minister to examine the rate relief afforded to these clubs. Other people have spoken about the bill, and just in the interest of brevity, and so I'll leave that part out. But let's go to some of the health-related benefits here. The aim of this legislation is about much more than saving money. Sports and physical exercise improve people's lives in so many ways. And I think, as other members said, you know, sports clubs just don't facilitate the young people look after. Our clubs look after all ages. And I suppose at this stage I should have declared my particular interest and my particular support of GAA over all my life. But it doesn't matter, irrespective of the sport, whether you're 8 or 80, there's a place for you. there's something there you can do meaningful, and particularly, as all the people mentioned about mental health and so on, particularly for some of our older generation who've retired, etc. You know, the idea of the men's shed and other ideas keeps people gainfully occupied and so on. Only our sports clubs are there, and people are volunteering to keep those sports clubs open, that are collecting the £1 or the gift aid to keep the electricity and heat on. This wouldn't happen in our communities. Obviously, physical activity contributes generally to the health and well-being and saves society millions of pounds annually. It saves hundreds of lives. On the other hand, physical inactivity is costing us millions year on year. They improve people's mental health, create social capital, which is the cement that binds society together and creates a more cohesive society. Those who participate in sporting activities that are provided by the sports club benefit from this physical activity, but they also learn other important skills. And as said previously, the idea of teamwork, loyalty, selflessness, volunteering, you know, and then these skills can then be transferred on to other people, onto family, in the school, the workplace and the community. It's impossible to place a monetary value on the benefits that we can achieve out of our sports clubs. Right across my own constituency, right across South Down, I think of the great work of the volunteers who run the soccer, who run the athletics, the rugby, the GAA. But who could do it without the volunteers? In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, the bill calls for rate relief afforded to those CASCs to rise from 80% to 100% to ensure parity with equivalent clubs in other parts of the UK. We all recognise the provision of 100% rate relief in the UK is discretionary, and that this is up to the local authority to decide whether it should be awarded. I too regret the petition, because this chamber is the place to debate this, to argue this out, so that we can get a bill that maybe needs a few amendments in it, whatever else. But let's debate it here to ensure we have something meaningful for our community that we can pass on to the future generations. I fully support the bill and believe rate relief should be introduced in full and should not be discretionary. I would like to commend Dahi McKay for bringing this bill forward. Like my colleague Dominic here, I support the bill moving to the committee stage for further scrutiny. Thank you.
I call Ms. Judith Cochrane.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on the Rates Relief for Amateur Sports Clubs Bill. And again, would like to commend the member for his hard work thus far. I'm currently taking my own private member's bill through, and I know when you don't have the power of the department behind you, it takes a lot of effort. Mr. Deputy Speaker, there's no doubt that our community amateur sports clubs play an important role in Northern Ireland. Having been a member of a women's hockey club for many years, some would say well past my playing career should have ended, I know the positive impact that being involved in sports can have on both physical and mental health. These clubs also provide activities for young people, and many are involved in positive community relations work. And I think it is important, therefore, that as an Assembly we do all that we can to support these clubs in their growth and in their sustainability. Like many businesses, organisations and households, our amateur sports clubs have faced greater overheads in recent years through, for example, the rise in utility costs. And furthermore, many of these clubs have also been hit by the loss of sponsorship due to the general downturn in the economy, and as a result are struggling to balance their books. And as already has been stated, currently the amateur sports clubs in Northern Ireland can, under Article 31 of the Rates Northern Ireland Order 1977, they can qualify for a reduction in rates relief of 80%. To qualify for it, the amateur sports clubs must comply with the requirements in Article 31 and meet the required definition as contained in the legislation. And this bill proposed today would seek to exempt the registered community amateur sports clubs from the payment of rates, and then those clubs which are not registered as such would still be able to continue to avail of the 80% rate relief. Furthermore, as has been discussed by the member, the proposal would ensure that the 100% rate relief would not apply to the part of the club which sells alcohol other than by way of an occasional licence, but will apply to the rest of the club premises, for example, the gyms and the changing rooms and stuff. Whilst I support the bill in principle, there are a number of issues that would require further input. However, given the tabling of the petition of concern, it's unclear whether we are now going to have the opportunity to do that. Should the bill pass the second stage, I probably would question whether the proposal which would exempt the bar area from receiving 100% relief, whether that actually goes far enough. Perhaps it would be necessary to further explore the mechanism by which rates are assessed in order to determine whether the 80% relief is actually excessive in those clubs who benefit from extensive social facilities. And I know, and it has already been discussed, there would be a view out there in the hospitality trade that those clubs with successful social components are already getting a good deal. Mr Deputy Speaker, there have also been a number of other issues raised by various departments in relation to the proposals in the bill. The Department of Justice, for instance, expressed concern that the 100% rate relief could, in certain circumstances, act as a passport for different treatment under criminal damage legislation. The Department of the Environment suggested that enhanced relief could have a potential impact on the derating grant, and the Department for Enterprise, Trade and Investment raised the matter of potential non-compliance with state aid rules. And I appreciate that the proposer of the bill has said that these are perhaps red herrings. However, I feel more work would need to be done to iron out some of those issues. So, Mr Deputy Speaker, I believe the bill does come forward with a proposal that could be refined in later stages. And in the absence of any current legislation coming forward from the Department for Finance and Personnel, I would support its passage today in order to scrutinise it further. Thank you.
Well, Mr John McAllister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, in rising, I want to first of all congratulate Mr Mackay on bringing the bill to this stage. I think when I look around at the legislation, most of which have been debated in recent days have come from backbenchers and indeed a committee bill earlier on today. And yet the main reason, I suppose, for blocking the bill is in the hope that our executive is somehow going to bring another policy option to the table, or an enhanced policy option to the table. My concern about that, when we look at all of the intentions of this bill, and fully accept Ms Cochrane's points that any bill is to take advantage of the processes of this Assembly, of a committee stage, yet we are in a position that we're effectively been told we need more time to consult, but we're going to do it then by accelerated passage. The very point of having a committee stage allows the committee to consult. That is one of the key points. And the very driving policy objective that Mr Mackay has outlined from the start of this process has been about helping amateur sports clubs. We have to look over recent weeks, and we've had huge reason for sporting pride in Northern Ireland, indeed across Ireland, right? With our rugby team, our football team doing so well. And literally, Deputy Speaker, every one of those people would have started off their careers and their early days in playing sport in an amateur sports club. One of the ones that I know very well, obviously, is Banbridge Rugby Club. And you may have heard of a rugby player that started his career there, Rory Best. You know, that is what the contribution that amateur sports clubs give and bring to Northern Ireland. And of course, the very points that have been made about that knock-on effect, that drive, the volunteerism that it creates, people giving up of their time and talents to give so much to a club, to raise money, to coach youngsters, to do all of that stuff. That is what I believe the driving policy is, and why I've been supportive of the policy objectives that Mr Mackay has set out. Mr McElduff mentioned about, in response to Mr Bradley, about the knock-on effect of sports clubs holding events in various hotels and functions. Of course, I disapprove strongly of people going over the border to take advantage of the euro, but that's a debate for another day. The point that there is a huge knock-on effect, the sheer numbers of people involved in sporting clubs, I think is something that we cannot underestimate. And all, virtually all of it given up freely to help give a significant, a mammoth benefit to our society, and whether it is in keeping young people occupied in health and fitness, and the well and long established link, Deputy Speaker, between good physical health and good mental health. Certainly.
We're forgiven way. The member has, and as with Mr. Rogers, has attended various local sports clubs in South Down alongside myself and other MLAs and MP and everything else at events such as suicide awareness, mental health awareness, even road safety events. These are the sort of the extracurricular, the extra events that clubs are actually filling the gaps of departments, what really should be doing, what government should really be doing, are filling the gaps. But how long, with immigration and with the tight economic times, are maybe having to turn away from these sort of events because they need to look after their own sporting events? You know, this is an item that really needs to be addressed, and we should be doing everything we can, no doubt the member will agree, to alleviate such hard times on our amateur sports clubs.
Deputy Speaker, because not only are they the point of contact, whether it can be for first aid training, whether it is giving our community police officers a way in to speak and engage with communities, all of that work is absolutely vital. And my huge disappointment, and I do hope even at this late stage the Minister and their party reconsider the application of the petition of concern, because the difficulty with that is that literally on the, I think it was the 9th of September, when DfP officials attended the committee, they were in broad agreement with say, some of the policy aims, but wanting to extend it and wanting to improve it. Well, I would have to say, look at other examples. The first private member's bill that Mr. Mackay did was on plastic bags tax. And the department at that point engaged with him, changed his bill, but used the bill to bring the legislation and to make it work. Mr. Agnew, on his children's services bill, and I think the minister responded to that bill, engaged with departments and changed the bill significantly. That is why I would urge the department to use Mr. Mackay's bill so that it can go through its assembly processes. There's broad agreement from round the chamber, from all other parties, that this is a good policy direction. There's broad agreement that we should be doing this, so use the bill as a vehicle to do that. My only doubts about that is that we are now being told by the departmental officials is that we are going to bring our own bill. It gives us more time to consult, but then we're going to ask the committee to agree, and this House to agree, to accelerated passage. Now, I'm not a huge fan of accelerated passage because I think it bypasses and short circuits the good processes, the type of scrutiny that a committee can bring to a bill. And any bill, even departmental bills with all of the machinery of government and a bills team behind them, will need technical amendments, will need changes, will need questions about policy direction answered. And there was ample time. Mr. McGuire hasn't exactly pulled this bill out of thin air sort of a few weeks ago. This bill has been consulted on. It has been through the process. He has had meetings with people and meetings about meetings on dealing with this bill and these issues. And yet we are now faced with the choice, Deputy Speaker, of, if only we had a bit more of a choice, of either letting the bill go through today or getting nothing, or possibly getting a bill from the department and then we end up with possibly nothing. We might get a bill, we might not. I know, Deputy Speaker, that Mr. Nesbitt was to bring a bill about defamation, and that was conveniently killed off by DfP by promising that they would take a look at it, and no such bill has come before this House. So that is my huge concern, is that we are about to kill this bill at second stage with no idea of an exact timeline, what all is going to be in the department's own bill in addressing this, and that is a major problem for us, because we could very well end up at the end of the mandate with nothing, with no help for the amateur sports clubs that Mr Mackay has wanted to bring. We end up with nothing. We have an executive that is not meeting. We have ministers that there are very few in office. We don't know when that's going to end, when the executive is going to start to meet. We don't know when the minister can get her bill out of the executive and fully drafted and out and approved out of the executive. All of those things, Deputy Speaker, give us a major difficulty in dealing with this. So I would plead with the minister to support the second stage of this bill and use the bill as a vehicle to deliver on some of the changes that I know that the department would like to see made. And if necessary, to make the changes with regard to the shopping centre issues that I know the department want to change, bring a bill to do that. Bring a separate bill if necessary. If it can't be fitted into this bill, bring a separate bill to do that. But it makes absolutely no sense to kill a bill before this chamber that has support from all other political parties, because it doesn't suit in with a process that the department want, and then to consult and to ask this House and this committee for an accelerated passage. It just makes no sense to do. I support the broad principles of the bill, and I certainly hope that the Minister has a rethink on this.
I call the Minister of Finance and Personnel, Mrs Arlene Foster, to respond.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. There's a wide range of issues that I need to cover, so I hope that members will bear with me just as I have bared with them, as I've listened to some points which are actually factually not correct. I stopped myself from intervening because I knew I was going to be able to address those in my speech. In terms of, first of all, the petition of concern, I'm certainly not going to take lectures from Sinn Féin on the misuse of the petition of concern. We've had a petition of concern to stop this House from sanctioning Gerry Kelly when he was on top of a Land Rover, a police Land Rover at that. We've had Sinn Féin using the petition of concern to exclude when we wanted to change the definition of a victim. And they indeed joined with the SDLP on a petition of concern in relation to welfare reform. So, you know, physician, heal thyself, is what I say in relation to the petition of concern in relation to these matters. And people need to think of that.
Point of order.
Okay. I just want to check with the Deputy Speaker that the Minister is indeed speaking as Minister, or perhaps could make it clear that she's speaking in a party political capacity.
I understand that the Minister is speaking as a Minister.
The Minister is addressing issues that have been raised, and I thought that I was going to answer the issues that have been raised because, Mr Deputy Speaker, I was asked direct questions in relation to the petition of concern, and therefore I am answering those issues in relation to the petition of concern. I do also want to say, before I forget, Mr Deputy Speaker, that I apologise to those speakers who may have noticed that I had to pop out of the chamber for a little while. There's a very important function in the Long Gallery at the moment in relation to Mid-Ulster's economic development plan. They were very upset that I had to leave when Mr McAlduff was speaking, but I assured them that I had someone here to take copious notes in relation to his speech and that I would address them when I returned. The bill presents a number of issues, and I'm afraid I will not be supporting it. I have two main issues and a number of other ancillary issues in relation to the bill. One is to do with due process. It is important to highlight, first of all, that in presenting the bill to the Assembly, that there has been a distinct lack of meaningful consultation in relation to this bill. We had a long, long list of amateur sports clubs listed out to us. Well, I can't say I was incredibly surprised that they wanted to see a reduction in their rates, Mr Deputy Speaker. I didn't hear from any of the hospitality or indeed Federation of Small Business or NERTA or the Federation of Hoteliers whether they had a view in relation to this bill. And to my mind, asking a number of sports associations if they would like to pay less rates doesn't really fall within the definition of meaningful consultation. Asking, yes, I will give way. Even though I said I wasn't giving way, I will give way.
I thank the Minister for her generosity on this occasion. Perhaps she can clarify to the House whether the DUP party, which she represents, received a copy of the consultation document and whether the party actually submitted a response to the public consultation.
Well, I'm going on to talk about the consultation document because I think people need to understand what it consisted of as well. Just so members are aware, the consultation document, which was described by Mr McElduff as a very good process, Mr Mackay put forward has the following specific contents. Less than one page in relation to the existing framework, less than one page in relation to his proposal, and then it has three pages of questions, and I want to read out some of those incisive questions which were put to those people who wanted to respond. Do you support the proposal to make amateur sports clubs exempt from rates? To amateur sports clubs, this question was asked. Do you agree that this legislation is the best way to address the issue? Do you think that the Rates NI Order 1977 should be amended to ensure that all community and amateur sports clubs are fully exempt from rates? How do you think the proposed legislation will impact on human rights? How do you think the proposed legislation will impact on equality of opportunity? Well, these are all really incisive and to the point in relation to the impact that this is going to have. It's a side issue, Mr Deputy Speaker, but can you imagine the reception which my department would get in presenting such shallow proposals for change to the Finance Committee, of which Mr Mackay is the chairman? Some analysis of cost would have been helpful, I have to say. There may only be around 200 registered community and amateur sports club in Northern Ireland, but if they're all to get 100% relief through this bill, then I think we can expect a surge in additional registrations. If we're not careful, we're going to have every well-meaning group move to seek a willing MLA to promote a bill giving more rate relief. We've already heard from Mr Somerville, who unintentionally amusing, as usual, talked about empty benches and he was sitting on one, and then went on to tell us that his colleague wanted homing pigeons and their associations involved in rate relief as well. So you can see, without a proper assessment of need and affordability, we're entering into this realm. The rating system is an intrinsic part of the public expenditure system. It's not something that should deliver support under the counter and outside the priorities of the executive, which of course sets the programme for government. And if we do not exercise caution, we'll soon, Mr Deputy Speaker, be playing spot the ratepayer in Northern Ireland. We give so many reliefs right across the piece, and we've got to act responsibly. Now, that's not the first time you've heard me talking about acting responsibly, but obviously people think that they can just give everybody rates reliefs and will not notice in terms of public finances what happens. Mr Mackay's party wants extra money for welfare reform, and at the same time he's coming knocking on the door of the rating system to increase already generous supports to sports clubs. And you know, you think, listening to some of the members today, that sports clubs do not get any assistance or any help at all. And of course that's not the case. They do get 80% relief in relation to their rating bills. So does the member realise that people are practically queued up every week at the Department of Finance and Personnel for rate relief on one issue or another? You only have to listen to my question time in relation to what are we doing in relation to rate relief for X, Y or Z. And it may be worth remembering that rates are a devolved tax and that central and local government need a stable tax base in order to plan and in order to be able to pay money out in relation to our public services. There's been, not in the House I have to say tonight, but I heard there was some commentary in relation to whether this was an orange and green issue earlier on, which was absolute rubbish, of course, but there are some particular broadcasters and some particular newspapers that just love it when you mention the words orange and green. So let's put the matter straight, and I want to put it on the record. What the member is proposing is a completely different beast to the terms of what people are calling Orange Hall exemptions. First of all, the exemptions is not just for Orange Halls, it's community halls, and that includes Orange Halls and Hibernian Halls. Secondly, it is conditional on them being able to use it for the wider community. And thirdly, and most importantly, they do not have a liquor licence and are not being occupied by a registered club. Any club with a liquor licence will have a regular stream of income and can afford to pay some rates, and they also have membership fees. And I'm amenable to looking at a model like this for CASC clubs, but only after the necessary due diligence, which I have to say is absolutely lacking from the work that Mr. Mackay claims to have carried out. Then we come to the state aid issue, which apparently is a red herring. Apparently state aid is now a red herring, and the member has not given any thought to this issue at all, and clearly by the fact that he calls it a red herring. Rate relief for community amateur sports clubs was the subject of a recent state aid case in Great Britain taken against Her Majesty's Government, and the decision was not reported until the end of April. I listened to Mr. Somerville talk about why hasn't she done anything for 4 years in relation to this issue. I actually take state aid as quite an important issue in relation to legislation. And it remains an issue for us, and an assessment needs to be made so that we don't fall foul of the state aid rules. It is a finely balanced judgment. No, I won't. It is a finely balanced judgment. And although I'm sure that Mr. Mackay would stand shoulder to shoulder with me if my department had to claw back rates relief from ratepayers if we did fall foul of state aid rules, because that would happen, and we would have to go out and get that money from the ratepayers. It's an issue that was raised by the Deputy Minister, and I'm all too aware of given my 8 years in that role. However, other ministers in their departments also have further concerns. So the Deputy Minister had the concern over state aid. The Department of Environment, of course, will have consequential costs in relation to their D-rating grant. I notice that the DOE Minister is happy with this bill, but then the DOE Minister also wants me to find the increased costs to facilitate him to make exactly the same grant. So give the money away, but give me the same money, because I want to give the same amount of money to the DOE. And what about the issues in relation to DOJ and the policy on criminal damage compensation? Have those been addressed? No, they haven't been addressed. And finally, what has been done to address the issues raised by his own party colleague, the DECAL Minister, in her department's letter to the Finance Committee in May of last year, raising vital issues around social clauses, maximum relief assessment, bar facilities, similar concerns that have been raised by the hospitality sector. And again, surprise, surprise, the DECAL Minister said there should be no impact on DECAL's budget baseline. So everybody wants relief, but nobody wants to pay for it. And that's the fundamental issue. Doesn't surprise me. But again, we come up against that with Sinn Féin. Another party colleague of his, Marcin O'Muller, at the committee in September stated that all around the table, no one wants to give 100% rates relief to amateur sports club that also run successful bars, catering operations and function rooms. That was his colleague, Marcin O'Muller. And Mr. Mackay's response to this is to apportion out the bars, the lounges, the restaurants, the function rooms, so that only sporting facilities get 100% relief. Now that sounds very attractive, but when you actually look into it properly, you'll find that the rates levied on club rooms are based on cost, which already leads to a hidden subsidy. When you compare that to rates paid per square foot by licensed premises and hotels, because they pay their rates on receipts and expenditures. And it is hard enough, and I completely reject, doesn't surprise me, this sort of nonsense that's thrown out from Sinn Féin, that we're beholden to the business community and it must be some hidden interest. I completely reject that. This is anti-competitive, and it's hard enough for some. I beg your pardon?
Order. Minister will resume her seat. I would ask members, please, not to make any remarks from a sedentary position. When members were addressing the Assembly, the Minister did not do that, so I would expect others to do the same.
I would expect nothing less, Mr Deputy Speaker. It is hard enough for pubs and restaurants to compete as matters stand. It's not just for food and drink, it's the whole function trade in some areas, and it's not just the licensed trade either. I've had numerous representations in relation to privately owned golf clubs, for example. Many of them, in fact, one of them in the member's constituency, very exercised by the fact that amateur sports clubs get relief on their rates, and yet they have to compete whilst paying full rates. And these are people who have diversified out of farming and have ploughed their own money into a new enterprise, and yet this bill would further disadvantage those people. So we simply can't make an uneven playing field more uneven. Asking clubs with successful social facilities to pay just 20% rates on the sporting facilities strikes me not an unreasonable balance, and this is the question we should be asking ourselves today. What I would support is a model along the lines that applies to community halls, which would allow community amateur sports clubs to get 100% relief if they don't have a permanent licence. However, I did put this to the proposer when I met him earlier this month. He refused to consider it, to Mr McAllister's point, and perhaps the Assembly would take a different view of it if they knew that, that I did ask the member if the department could take over his legislation and deal with these issues, and he refused. He refused. And as things stand, Mr Speaker, I cannot support the bill. It would set a precedent for well-meaning but ill-conceived proposals being thrown together in private members' bills in order to introduce new rates reliefs. And I'll be here every week making changes to rating legislation unless we insist on some standards in relation to policy development. That's in relation to due process. There's also the separate issue relating to the drafting of the private members' bill. And with your indulgence, Mr Deputy Speaker, allow me to move on to this. Mr McKay's bill requires the community and amateur sports club designation to be shown in the non-domestic valuation list. What's the problem with that, you may say? Well, it won't work because this is a statutory public document and contains no such designation. It simply, again, underlines the lack of care in bringing forward this bill. So I've outlined the fundamental problems I have with the bill, problems that I have brought to the attention of the mover of the bill many months ago and which have been ignored. The issue needs now to come back to the department, and that's nothing to do with taking credit for legislation, but this Assembly cannot pass legislation that doesn't take full account of consequences and risks, consequences for the business community and risks to my department that the legislation will be challenged. It is my assessment that there will need to be a further consultation targeted and over 8 weeks to allow the department to assess and bottom out these issues. And the department's approach will, out of necessity, be run on a parallel process, one process associated with the progression of the primary enabling power and another to complete due process work on the consultation. But of course, that all depends on how the Department of Finance and Personnel Committee is going to react to that, because they may well decide, no, we don't want to play ball, we're going to huff because you wouldn't allow this bill to proceed. Well, I would urge them to look at what is the bigger prize here, and the bigger prize is having legislation that is properly thought out, properly dealt with in relation to the risks and assessments, and we will be able to do that if they allow us to deal with them in a proactive way. Yes, I will give way.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I'm grateful to the Minister. Has the Minister a definite timeline on when she thinks she could produce that draft bill?
Well, we have drafting already completed, We would be keen to move on this as quickly as possible, but of course there's very little point in us moving ahead if the committee decides that they're going to block accelerated passage and not allow us to move forward. Actually, in relation to the issue of the window dressing rates relief, which was brought to us by the manager of the Buttercrane shopping centre, that has already been consulted on and so is ready to go at the moment. So we don't need to consult on that particular point. And of course, the bill that we're proposing is an enabling piece of legislation. It's not a detailed piece of legislation. So we would be able to move on it quickly. However, that's a matter for the committee. I'm happy to work with them in relation to this matter. But as things stand, we will be voting against this bill. I will be voting against this bill as Minister of Finance and Personnel.
I call Mr. Dati Mackay to conclude and wind up the debate. Mr. Mackay.
May I get a last inquiry raised to respond to the debate, and then we'll come back later to some of the inaccurate comments that have been made, which have been misleading to this House. The first speaker, the Deputy Chair of the Committee, I'm going to take this opportunity to thank the Committee for its work and indeed to thank the Deputy Chair for his work. I understand he's moving on to Pastures Green. He's escaping this place. I wish him well in the future in that regard. The bill unfortunately looks like it will not go to the committee, as Dominic has outlined, and he also touched upon the issue of preventative spending, something that has been an issue for the Finance and Personnel Committee, the concept of investing to save for MLAs, and indeed the executive to take a more long-term strategic view in terms of how we spend public money and how we can reap dividends in terms of social impact, in terms of value for money in the longer term, and certainly in terms of the areas of obesity and diabetes, this would be preventative spending. He also referred to the cross-community benefits of community and amateur sports clubs, and I know even one example in my own community where a local GAA club and a local rugby club worked together to build bridges in a community where there were cross-community issues, and that has reaped dividend, has developed friendships, it has built links. So sport clubs do play a vital role in bringing the entire community together. He also referred to the issue of clubs that are registered as charities, and of course those that are registered as charities get 100% relief. So more clubs may decide to go down that road if the 100% relief option is not opened for them. He also referred to the call for evidence that the committee, not me, the committee put out over the summer period in which there was no concerns raised. Some of the concerns raised on the other side of the House. No concerns were raised by any organisations over the summer period. And only yesterday, a response was received by Hospitality, Ulster at a very late stage in terms of some of their concerns. And there's been quite a significant reaction to that from not only sports clubs but some businesses, some bars and restaurants too. As the Deputy Chair rightly said, committee stage will give businesses another opportunity to reply, will give organisations that represent the business community an opportunity to respond, because that is what committee stage is for. We are only at second stage of this bill, and there has been many times in the past when members of all parties have agreed to the principles of the bill, the very broad principles of the bill, and agreed that we need to look at amendments elsewhere. And the more reasoned position that the party opposite should have taken was the position outlined by Ms Cochrane, in that, yes, she has concerns around the bill, some of them similar to what the Minister has outlined, but the place to deal with them is the committee stage, as a consideration stage and further consideration stage. The Deputy Chair then indicated that the SDLP agrees with the general principles of the bill and said that the deployment of this petition of concern is anti-democratic, and I think that will prove to be the case, because it is quite clear that the majority of MLAs in this House and the majority of parties in this House, bar one, supports this proposal moving forward in the House. And I also cited a great example, the programme last night about suicide within the GAA, a big issue not only obviously for the GAA but all sporting organisations, for rural communities where I come from too, and all sporting organisations, all sporting codes do fantastic work in regard to the area of suicide prevention. Neil Somerville responded on behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party. And can I take the opportunity to welcome Mr Somerville to the Assembly? Our paths have not yet crossed since he took up his post. He also outlined the fact that this is an abuse of the petition of concern, and he rightly said the petition of concern was never intended to thwart run-of-the-mill legislation. And there's nothing. I mean, some of the issues outlined in terms of Mr Kelly, a member of this House, in terms of other issues, they are more controversial issues. But community and amateur sports clubs and the work they do is not controversial in any way. And he also said it would not be a massive cost. And of course, the DUP have had 4 years to introduce a bill, and nothing's happened until this bill came to the House. Mr Michael Duff indicated that there is huge support for the bill in the community, and referred to the public engagement that was held in Struil Arts Centre in Oma, and the variety, and I remember well the variety of sporting clubs that did attend that evening in terms of tennis, in terms of bowling, and in terms of GAC. And he rightly said that this should be an exemplar. We should be an exemplar for Europe and the rest of the world in terms of supporting community sports. So there is an opportunity here to show that we can do something different, something good, without it being shot down here today. He also spoke, took the opportunity to speak to hospitality providers today who are universally supportive of it, and strongly, he was strongly critical of Hospitality Ulster for being out of touch and not representative. And in terms of his intervention, the Deputy Chair rightly said that in terms of amateur and community sports clubs, you know, I've lost count of the amount of dinners I've been at for amateur sports clubs in Ballymena, Ballycastle, Port Lanoan, sometimes on quite a regular basis. You know, so that's something that goes on in our communities all the time, and it makes those hotels, those restaurants, those bars a lot of profit. So this goes both ways. In terms of the bars that are within clubs, they're staffed mainly in terms of a voluntary basis. It isn't people that are going out to make a profit. It is people who are volunteering their time to better their club, to ensure that money can be raised for good purposes, for supporting their young people, for sports equipment and so on and so forth. So it's a very, very worthwhile cause. Bronwyn McGahan opened up by stating that she was a former Gaelic footballer and a cyclist. She didn't say she's a very good cyclist, and has often seen going up and down the hills of Tyrone on a Sunday afternoon. She rightly said about the effects that austerity and the Tory government policy is having throughout the entire community, and that shouldn't be forgotten either. And she also referred to the grants, the various grant schemes that clubs apply to. They repeatedly go back to different organisations to get a couple of hundred pounds here and a couple of hundred pounds there. But the Sports Forum did do some work and some research in regard to this, and most sports clubs would like something simple and something direct. And if they were to have a rates exemption of 100%, then that would be a lot better than filling out 20 or 30 page forms every year to try and scrape by year in, year out. This is a simple bill. It is designed to be so, and that is why it would be so effective. Sean Rogers rightly said that sports clubs are the glue of our communities, and there's certainly many young people with the herd running up and down the streets of North Antrim, I can assure him, and also in parts of County Down as well, I shouldn't hasten to add. And of course, there's a variety of sport in all our communities. Running, cycling have really taken off in recent years, and of course football, rugby, boxing is a big sport where I'm from as well, and that should not be forgotten either, especially in terms of the success that we have generated in areas like rugby, as Mr McAllister referred to, but also in terms of boxing. We have produced some world-class athletes, and they have started off, and some, and pardon me for saying it, some of the dirtiest, most run-down facilities you've seen. So when you go into some of the boxing clubs, and I can think of boxing clubs in my own constituency where it's covered in damp, and they cannot get facilities, they find it hard to scrape by and get support, and I think they deserve extra money so they can improve the environment that they are delivering this service for our young people in our communities. And some of the young people concerned are hard to reach young people. Some come from disadvantaged backgrounds. And for many young people, this is a big opportunity. Sports gives them the opportunity to move on in life, to develop skills. And many young people that I know of credit the sport and credit the sporting code they're involved in for turning their life around. So we shouldn't forget that, and we shouldn't forget the impact that these clubs truly have in our community. Judith Cochran, also former hockey player, I don't know how good she was, she might tell us later on, outlined the importance for youth and community relations, and again, in terms of the loss of sponsorship for clubs, she supports the bill in principle, but we'll go further in regard to the issue around the bar or the social club. Also, rightly said, there's concerns from departments and would welcome further scrutiny. And indeed, I would welcome further scrutiny as well, because there are concerns. I want to see all concerns addressed. I'm not running away from them by any in any way, so they should be responded to in the way that this legislative process that we have was designed to do, in terms of committee stage, consideration stage, and further consideration. And then, if the DUP want to torpedo the bill at final stage, well, they can do it then, but it is a bit disingenuous to outline concerns and not even take the opportunity to address them through the various stages of the bill. John McAllister, again, of course, referred to the fact that the committee stage is to consult. He rightly referred to the sporting pride that we have seen in recent weeks, not only in terms of the north, but across the island in terms of rugby and soccer alike. And we've produced some fine players in terms of rugby and soccer. And he's right, they all started in an amateur boxing club. Rory Best started the Banbridge Rugby Football Club, and of course Banbridge responded to this consultation, responded in support of it. And they deserve this support to produce more Rory Best. That's what we want to see. We want to see more success on the international stage. And the way to do that is not to be being stingy about it, because this is a drop in the ocean in terms of the overall budget. And these clubs do deserve our support. Chris Hazard also referred to what he called the extracurricular events that clubs hold in terms of road safety. I know of a number of clubs engage with the PSNI to hold road safety events on their grounds, suicide awareness and mental health. So it isn't just exclusively sport that is dealt with within these clubs. It is more holistic. And these services that are being provided, if it was local councils that were doing it, if it was the various health trusts that were doing these things, it would cost hundreds of pounds, thousands of pounds, in terms of employees' time and all the rest of it. These are volunteers. They do it for nothing. They give up all their time. They open up facilities. They staff facilities for no cost. And yet we are complaining about the cost of a few hundred pounds to a club here or a few thousand pounds to a club there. We do need to look at the costs of this in the round, not just in terms of rates, but also of the cost that we would have to pay in terms of central government and local government if these clubs were not there. And Mr. McAllister also rightly flagged up the example of the plastic bag levy bill that morphed into the Carrier Bag Levy Act at the end, and the bill totally transformed into something else. And that is the art of making legislation, or that has been compared to making sausages. You don't necessarily want to see the ins and outs of it. So that in itself outlines the ridiculousness of the position that's been outlined across the floor. If they were serious about making the changes that they've outlined, they could simply have put amendments forward. I think taking your ball and running home in the way that they're doing today is totally disingenuous. Mr McAllister outlined his concern, rightly, that the department might get a bill through and they might not, and we could end up with nothing for community and amateur sports clubs at the end of the mandate, and I rightly share that concern. Mrs Foster, the Minister, outlined two main issues, and she drew a lot of criticism, or my consultation drew a lot of criticism, but I also took a quick Google there at some of the members of the DUP who have also had private members' bills consultations. I'm not picking on Mr McElveen just because he's sitting there, but his consultation was pretty similar to the structure that I used as well. And in terms of Mr Gibbons' consultation, there were seven questions to it. So this is the nature of private members' bills. You know, we do not have a department behind us to give us a 200-page document. You know, the department have produced 100, 200-page consultation documents that haven't even got five responses. I produced a short, sharp consultation document that has got over 1,000 responses. So I think that speaks for itself. So members can nitpick over the quality of it, but it was designed to be simple. We're talking about a bill with four clauses. We're not talking about something complex. We're talking about a simple change to the 1977 order. In terms of cost analysis, we had very little from the department to work from. We were told that there's no up-to-date figures, that certain things can't be calculated. So I find it highly ironic that the Minister is criticising me in terms of cost analysis when her own department couldn't produce them. You know, the department could have been more helpful, but, you know, my understanding was that because of the way LPS is designed, the way these statistics are gathered, that it was a genuine difficulty in getting these statistics, and I certainly give them the benefit of the doubt. Now, if Minister Foster is saying that I should have been able to get better analysis, then maybe her own officials should have been able to get the same as well. So that's another red herring, I think, that the Minister has given forward today. In terms of orange and green issues, as she's referred to, this isn't an avenue that I have gone down. Whatever about the provisions in the 2006 order for halls, that was in that order, that's in the past. What we want to deal with is community and amateur sport clubs, because they deliver for all communities, orange, green, black, yellow, purple, whatever. You know, so that issue is one for others to debate. However, what we want to see is GAA clubs, rugby clubs, boxing clubs, clubs and unionist communities, nationalist communities and other, all receive support across the board. Now, I don't think anybody should be opposing that.
What would the member give way?
Yep.
I thank the member for giving way. I'll probably best declare an interest as a member of an amateur sporting club that pays rates of £1,700 a year. And I was at a meeting of that organisation last night where people at the meeting were aghast at this proposed petition of concern from the DUP. And I've fielded a number of calls in the last 24 hours from amateur sporting clubs in my constituency that were delighted to hear that this proposal was going through and are now furious that it's not going to happen anymore. But the member's talking about red herrings and issues of that nature that the Minister has raised. And one of the issues she kept falling back on was this issue of competition between hotels and amateur sporting clubs, as if they were competing on a level playing field. Does the member think that hotels, which are there to generate a profit for its owners or shareholders, are comparable with amateur sporting clubs, which reinvest any kind of surplus at all that it gets into playing facilities and into service for its local community? Or does a member think that a hotel is actually competing with amateur sporting clubs for trade in a local community?
The member's right. You're comparing apples and pears, really. The amateur sporting club is, as I've already stated, staffed by volunteers, and the hospitality industry operates in a completely different environment. But I think what is most concerning over the debate today, yesterday, and earlier in this week, is that there's this assumption that those who run hotels, those who run bars and restaurants, are automatically against this. Now, since last night, I've been inundated by bar managers, people I know who are involved in sports, saying, you know, what's been said does not represent us. And I think that needs to be taken into consideration in terms of the Minister's consultation, if she wants to bring something similar forward. So I think that's unfortunate. That's how things have developed over the past couple of days. But I think that all voices need to be listened to. The committee stage, as the committee stage has been for most bills in this Assembly, is the place where people, where groups, where organisations like Hospitality Ulster can come and give evidence, and committee can listen to what they're saying, and the committee can make amendments, and that is the way this process is to work. So, like I say again, it's disingenuous for the Minister to come here and make the point that she hasn't even had the courtesy to stay during this debate, or certainly my response to her comments. So that shows you how seriously she takes community and amateur sports clubs, that she hasn't stayed for the duration of this debate and ahead of the vote. And of course, she raised other issues in terms of the bill. She said the bill is anti-competitive. Well, I think to vote this down today, for the DUP to torpedo this bill, is anti-community, because, as Mr Rogers outlined earlier, the community and amateur sports clubs are the glue that hold many of our communities together. They deserve this recognition. They deserve this support. And if members want to tweak around the edges of the support that is put in place, they can put amendments to the bill. What the Minister outlined in terms of what she wants could have been done through amendments to this bill, which is already at second stage. So I don't understand, but I do understand why she couldn't have done that. And she also referred to casks and the proposal to get a permanent exemption from rates if they do not have a bar. First I've heard of it, last can't clear. She said this was discussed with me in a private meeting. That is wrong. Okay, it's first I have heard of it. But if, what I said to the Minister at the meeting last week was that I would be happy to work with the Department. If the Department or the Minister wanted to introduce amendments, then we can consider that, and the House can make a decision in regard to that. So that's new to me. I would like to see more detail. And perhaps the Finance Committee would like to see more detail as to what the Minister has in mind. Because at this moment in time, I think Mr McAllister referred to it earlier, we have no indication of a timeline for the Minister's bill. We were told that the bill from the Department could not be brought forward because my bill was already in the House. That was wrong as well. That bill could have came forward anyway. So we have no indication of a timeline. The commitment from the Minister is a bit unwieldy, and of course she wants to bring the bill to the House without it going through committee stage. That's bad legislation. That is a bill that hasn't had proper consultation if it doesn't go through the committees of this House.
To the member for giving way, Deputy Speaker, not only accelerated passage and bypassing the procedures of this House, she's also wanting to do it by enabling legislation where we don't have the same oversight over what the regulations would be or what we've been asked to do further down the track. At least using the legislative approach that you proposed, you would have oversight and control and in the proper democratic place in this chamber.
I thank the member for his intervention. He's spot on, because with this bill, what you see is what you get. You know, in terms of enabling legislation, the Minister could give the impression that she's going to give support for a community number of sports clubs and leaves that for regulation somewhere down the line at a date to be confirmed. You know, so the devil's in the detail, and the detail's not there. You know, so I would have considered withdrawing this bill today if I had that detail. The Minister didn't give me the detail. and it's quite disingenuous for her to come here and to outline a proposal that was put to me that wasn't put to me. So she should stop playing silly buggers and stop trying to mislead the public and actually outline, and I challenge the Minister to outline to the public, to outline to the rugby clubs, the soccer clubs, the boxing clubs, all amateur sport clubs, what exactly she is proposing to do, and see if it is enabling legislation. Okay, give us a date when you're actually going to give us something of substance. We haven't got that here today. The Minister is, I was going to say, she's taken her ball and went home, and she clearly has, but I think it's immature, because I knew that the Parliament had a bill in the offing. My bill was already ahead of it. I know that the Minister wanted to include in her bill an amendment in regard to window dressing in shops. So I think that's what it comes down to, is the fact that she did not want to support the bill because she wants to put her own bill forward with window dressing on it. You know, that is what it comes down to. It's immature, it's bad politics, it's a bad abuse of the petition of concern. And at the end of today, community and amateur sport clubs are left in the dark as to what support they may or may not get from the Department of Finance and Personnel. So the challenge is there, and I'll conclude on this point and ask Conor Quirr.
Will the member give way before he concludes? I thank the member for giving way, but having listened to the Minister's speech and indeed having read the Hansard from the recent presentation by departmental officials to the Finance and Personnel Committee, it's confusing and contradictory in the sense that the Minister says this isn't the right way to go about it. The consultation document and the consultation process was allegedly flawed, and here's a better way to introduce an extension of the rates relief for clubs. And then, on the other hand, says we can't afford it. You know,
order, so, please. I'm expecting the member maybe at some stage to ask Mr. Mackay a question. Otherwise, I will be put in a very difficult position that this debate has opened up again. And I'm trying to avoid that at this late hour.
I hear what the Deputy Speaker is saying, and far be it from me to put a man of your stature into a difficult position at this hour of the night. But my question is to whether the member has any understanding as to whether the party opposite are actually opposed to the proposal to offer 100% rates relief to community and amateur sports clubs, or whether their opposition stems from the fact that it's Mr. Mackay that's bringing forward the proposal.
Well, I think it's the latter. The Minister had an opportunity here today to outline her proposal in detail, and we're still left with a proposal that is bereft of detail. Now, that may change. I hope it does change, because at the end of the day, what I want is full support for community and amateur sports clubs, as I've outlined. But at the end of the day, the challenge to the Minister is this. If she is serious about providing support for community and amateur sports clubs, outline what it is, and instead of bringing forward some silly piece of enabling legislation with no date as to when clubs will actually get the support. You know, these community and amateur sports clubs didn't come up the van, or didn't come up the lagging in a bubble. You know, they know when they're being played. Now, if the Minister is serious, she needs to bring forward legislation, outline what the support is, and outline when clubs will get it. That's a challenge for the Minister. She has, along with her party, abused the processes of this House. She's also proposing to abuse the democratic process by bypassing the committee stage, as Mr. McAllister has outlined. So I hope that she reflects on the very strong views that are out there amongst community and amateur sports clubs, and comes back with a proper, detailed proposal that is subject to proper consultation, not a process that is bereft of consultation in this House, as she has proposed. So she needs to come back with that, go out to the community, have a proper consultation like I have had, and like I was proposing in terms of the consultation stage of this bill, and ensure that this is done by the time that the elections are held next year, because at the end of the day, communities are struggling out there. Clubs are struggling from across the community. Those that represent people of different religion, different gender, different sporting codes, they need support. They deserve that support, and the party and the Minister opposite really need to reflect on how they have abused not only this House, but also the clubs that are the heart and the glue of our communities.
Just me.
Yes.
Before we proceed to the question, I would remind members that a valid petition of concern has been presented. The vote on the second stage of this bill requires cross-community support. The question is that the second stage of the rates relief for community amateur sports clubs bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I don't think so. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the second stage rates relief for community amateur sports clubs bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Just go ahead, eh? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Datty Mackay and Cathal O'Oisin. Tellers for the noes are George Robison and David McElveen. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Thank you. Order. Members will resume their seats. Clerk, read the result.
Cross-community division result. 72 members voted, of which 41 voted aye, 56.9%. 28 nationalists voted, of which 28 voted aye, 100%. 39 unionists voted, of which 8 voted aye, 20.5%. 5 others voted, of which 5 voted aye, 100%. The bill does not pass its second stage.
The bill does not have its second stage. Unfasten the doors. Members, bear with us for a moment while we change the top table.